Mad cow disease. Mad cow disease. I suspect you'll find that, unlike appearances, mad cow disease has something in common with Lyme's disease in that they are not really new at all. Mutations, perhaps, but not new. In fact, Lyme's disease was reported in Europe in the Dark Ages, the real Dark Ages, back in the ancient history of Europe, not the 20th century before the Internet, though it was dark enough then. My Uncle Webb had a herd of cows back in Massachusetts in the early 19th century. He did talk to me about them, but you know how condescending folks are to toddlers, so I didn't get much input. Nor did I get much chance to inspect the herd, but I did get a chance to watch them returning to the barn in the late afternoons. The herd was healthy. Uncle Webb was one of those greatest of experts in all the world, the farmer. He lived beyond 100. I think I heard Dad say once he lived to be 110. But he lived beyond 100, and I have vague recollections of him making it beyond 110. So, then I suppose I have something to report. And I'd better get on with it and let it go into the wild web so we can take one step beyond. Of course, you know, I might as well be reading this out on the by a traffic light on Fifth Avenue in Manhattan during rush hour. Let it go on the net. Just nobody notices it. Just like, anyway, when a beast dies, such as a cow or large animal, even small ones, they join the part of the ecosystem known by us barbarians as the saprobic chain. That is the food chain of the underworld, of the unseen, of dendrites of mold and colonies of yeast, bacteria, fungi, and myriad. I use the word often because that is one of the gut basic terms of the cosmos. Other myriad other forms that break down what is scheduled to be broken down into the basics and returned to the soil to mix with the alluvial elements of the lithosphere and the meteoric dust of outer space. Now, in my world travels, I have seen unhealthy herds crowded together and made to stand penned up in the mud or even their own manure. Here's your harbinger of disease. In the turf beneath their feet, they get too close to the saprobic chain and their schedule arrives too early. The same conditions began to take place in the Dark Ages as things like personnel and their chattels and their cattle began to get closer together. This is where we see the advent of extraordinary disease. But it gets worse. The interconnection of squashed-in units, the diseases of plague proportions traveling the caravan routes from the Silk Roads of China. Someone might think, ah, there's a problem right there. So what we must do is simply spread out, and that solves that. Perhaps it's part of the answer, but not the whole answer, not quite. It's never that easy. There has been a form of mad cow disease among herbivorous North American wildlife for decades now. That has been common knowledge, and in the areas where the disease broke out, in Alberta province, in the Canadian side, and in Washington state, in the United States side, or the state's side, the wild herds of elk, among others, are mixing with the cattle as they get fed out. Now, I used to feed my cattle out. They weren't mine, but I took care of them for a friend in New Zealand while staying at his place in the southern part of the northern island near a town called Ohura. I'd go out and feed them the hay and give them hugs. When I took a break from writing and walked out on the hills, they'd gather behind me. When I grabbed my guitar and sang, they'd come running. Just a few head, nothing much to speak of. It was a micro tiny herd of a cow, a heifer, a bull, and 7 calves. Some herd, huh? A herdette. They were a part of a very large herd my friend's brother had until he went out of business, as so many New Zealander farmers had. The New Zealand farmers who failed were accused of bad financial management, but that wasn't the case. The fact is, as is common throughout the world, and is the aspect of human nature that really is the primary, you know, and is the aspect of human nature that really is the primary cause of disease, they were the victims of financial manipulation. That's your basic cause of disease right there, financial manipulation. It began in areas of the greatest ancient civilizations, particularly the Nile River Valley, the Ganges River Valley, but in particular the Yalu River Valley, and is still going on in the form in that region, in the form of annual flue mutations, and that now famous region from which emanates the old disease, which had an outbreak in the early 21st century called SARS, S-A-A-R-S. With civilization comes cures, and with cures come super germs. Because of the advent of primitive economic manipulation, the population and their food supplies, especially livestock, tended to bunch up, as it were, touching off the signal to the saprobic chain to begin the breakdown. Here we see the advent of the poxes, which tend to use the subcutaneous area of an organism or its respiratory areas to colonize the first tenets of breakdown to the elements. Toxic microorganisms. They tend to colonize where they can get a foothold in areas where blood-borne antibodies can't reach. At least can't reach very well. But here we're looking at the neural infections such as avian encephalitis and the mad cow type illnesses, as well as the nerve-damaging Lyme's diseases, prevalent among wild herds of deer, diseases that would impair the beast's ability to stay clear of top carnivores, diseases that still continue to work even though the TCs are no longer there, at least for now. Now, before I go further, I can't discuss the problem without offering the first elements of some sort of a solution. We know the populace will not turn from its mesmerization by economic power, so the solution must incorporate the bunching. Go to my website and look at my article about the calendar. Man's inept concept of a calendar is also a big part of the problem. Now, considering the other aspect of this saprobic chain, the wilderness aspect, we tend to divide them in our present primitive forms of ecology, you know. But that's something I learned from Uncle Webb's cows, because you see, toddlers don't realize they aren't supposed to be in a conversational mode with other species. It's cyclical. It's like a battery that recharges itself. Man is a part of nature, with his ecological niche, is perpetuated by the cycle of nature in his adapted farm. The impression is that ideally takes place without any outside interaction, in particular, monetary. With the herds in the wild, there are elements of the saprobic chain, such as parasites and toxic microorganisms, that initiate the cull of the hordes that are then followed up upon by the top carnivores of the food chain. The elk get sick and the wolves come up and bite their bottoms. That's the safest way for disproportionate top carnivores to bring down something that big. No more saber-toothed cats, at least for a while. That's perhaps why mad cow disease or herd-culling saprobitis, as I call it. Herd-culling saprobitis, as I call it, was first noted in England as what was thought of as a new disease. The fact is that man forgets. That's normal. Things like that can't be remembered indefinitely. Another big lesson to be learned. There, the top carnivores were eliminated by man, and over the ages, the biotic interface, which I have discussed in other articles in the medicine section of my website, was forgotten, primarily by a misinterpretation brought about by preoccupation with pecuniary power and its resultant delusionary state. Observe what the disease takes, you know. Observe that the disease takes only a section of the herd. The resultant neural damage and its characteristic spongiform appearance in view from autopsy is an evident aid to the predator to cull the beast. During times of abundance, which are thought of as plague conditions by people, up to 20% of the herd is infected so that they may be culled by whatever top carnivore might assist the saprobic chain to get on with what it deems to be its job. So far, the disease has been traced to a protein in the small intestine and in nervous tissue that could well be an immune response triggered by an infection of some sort, perhaps multiple infections, known and unknown. Also, I must point out that humans are susceptible to a form of the disease because we too occur in herds. Omnivores, perhaps, but then so are wild boars. I have discussed elements of this in my papers, which I'm still working on, called The Coming Plague. Well, you know, I found out it's like, could have come up with a more creative title. There may be at least 100 books and publications by that name. So, Anyway, in an obtuse manner of looking at it, one must really note, finally, that the economics that are really, that really are causing the problem among humans are seen in a new light that in part at least, and perhaps a major part, and I knew this since a child, the power of money is death. Or more properly put, decomposition. You know, as a child, I could understand the respect adults had for money, and an instinctive fear almost, as if there was the realization on the peripherals of the subconscious that death had some involvement, and therefore it was handled in a hushed manner, much like obsequies are handled at the morgue or the funerary. Certainly, it's not as simple as that, but it always plays a big part. And, you know, it's the economic pressure that causes a farmer's cows to stand in the mud or manure, their own feces, or causes the elk to mix with the cattle. That's the pressure that forces mankind into crowded urban conditions. That's what causes the expert farmers to go out of business and the business people to feed the cattle carcasses of the dead cattle to the living cattle. Causes business people to do such things as feed the cattle carcasses of the dead cattle. That's what causes people to become so preoccupied that they forget. And I alone am escaped to tell thee, the artist from the fringe, who lived outside the dictums of money, who traveled the earth in search of answers. These diseases emerge because you lose touch with prevention. There is a way to tidy up, in a manner of speaking, so that the ecology of decomposition doesn't come knocking on your door. There is a biotic interface, a way to discourse with the realities of the universe beyond economics, so that you are in line with the real protocols of health.